Bonjour et bienvenue dans l'entretien.
Hello and welcome to the France 24 interview. Today we are in Washington and our guest is Gérard Araud, France's ambassador to the United States.
Monsieur l'ambassadeur,
Mr. Ambassador, thank you for welcoming us and speaking with us.
Mr.
Ambassador, at 66 years of age, and after almost 40 years at the service of France, you have decided, and the administration has decided a little bit for you too, to leave your position and to leave French diplomacy. On several occasions during your career, you may have surprised and sometimes even shocked some, maybe your American interlocutors in particular. For example, there was November of 2016, when Donald Trump was elected, an event you didn't greet with great enthusiasm exactly. You said at the time that, quote, a world is disappearing before our eyes. It is the end of an era.
Devant nos yeux, c'est la fin d'une époque.
Why did you say this?
Justement, c'était absolument.
It was definitely not a message addressed to Donald Trump. This was after Brexit, after the election in the United States, and let's remember that no one had foreseen the election of Donald Trump.
Personne n'avait prévu l'élection de Donald Trump. J'ai eu le sentiment.
I had the feeling that the populist crisis was much more serious than we had thought, and therefore, when I said that a world was falling apart,
et donc lorsque j'ai dit qu'un monde,
it was the world made of things we took for granted.
Alors de manière assez curieuse d'ailleurs,
the tweet was a mistake and was only online for 2 minutes.
Il n'est resté que 2 minutes.
Do you regret it?
Oui, parce que.
Yes, because first of all, unfortunately, I wrote it at 2 in the morning, which was 8 a.m. in Paris. It was immediately quoted by all the radio stations and by all the TV channels. The far right took it out on me. That can't have upset you too much. Well, you know, in social media there can be a flood of hatred, and I have been the object of attacks, violent insults, often homophobic insults, which was quite unpleasant. I was wrong, but at the same time, this message did not have the slightest effect in the United States. Was there any kind of a reaction from the White House? Well, I wanted it to be known that we had all been wrong, and that what was happening was serious. And I was thinking above all about what could happen in France in May 2017 in the presidential election. And my feeling was that the same thing could happen there as well. Are you still pessimistic on that front? No, not when it comes to France, because in the end, Emmanuel Macron won the election. But I truly believe that we are going through the end of an era.
Nous vivons un changement d'ère.
My career began with the election of Reagan, and it ends with the election of Trump. I believe that that was a period that I would describe as homogenous. Basically, what we call the neoliberal period, with fewer taxes and no borders. The West has values that it must defend and expand. I think that after Brexit and Donald Trump, we had the yellow vest protesters in France, then the voters in Italy. We'll come back to the yellow vest protesters. That's one of my questions. The voters told us it's over. And it is true that this period ultimately was very positive for hundreds of millions of poor people in poor countries, for the rich in rich countries, but certainly not for the middle class, especially the lower middle class. You mentioned the yellow vest protesters rather spontaneously in your address to the French community here in the United States. You regularly interact with French citizens here in Washington and in other major American cities, and you've often spoken about those yellow vest protesters. Do you agree there might be a comparison to be made between this movement, with its sometimes violent protests, and Donald Trump's voters? At the beginning of the Yellow Vest movement in October, November and December, I think they expressed the same unease many of our fellow citizens had. This is no coincidence. It's often people who come from rural areas or small towns, people who feel left behind, abandoned by what has been called globalization. So I think that we can indeed compare the movement of the Yellow Vest protesters to the movement that led to the election of Donald Trump.
In July
2018, you reacted to a very popular late-night show here in the United States, The Daily Show, hosted by Trevor Noah, when he called the French football team the African team when they won the Football World Cup. You didn't like that at all. Why was that? Indeed, I didn't like that at all. First of all, because it took up exactly what the far right was saying in France on a purely racist basis, which was the idea that you are black, so you can't be French. Trevor Noah is, of course, South African. African and black. Yes, he is black himself, and so I reacted because of that. However, I was not surprised. There are subjects that the French and the Americans cannot agree upon. The first subject, in fact, is that subject of citizenship and the relationship between the community and the nation. And the second subject is secularism. I can tell you that I spent 4 years traveling around this country, defending France's vision. But it is still difficult to spread, because in a way, the United States has a different way of operating. If you're an Italian, if you came to the United States as an immigrant in the 19th century, well, first you went to a neighborhood where everyone was Italian. So that in a way you could live in the United States without speaking English. Your son would go to the American school, so he would be bilingual. He would be an Italian-American. And the grandson would only speak English. So there is an integration process, which still works quite well, but which is still based, in a sense, on respect for your community. Communitarianism? It's what we call communitarianism in a negative sense. It is a different way for society to function. For a country of immigrants entirely made up of immigrants, all Americans are immigrants. With the exception of the poor Native Americans, it was a way of living that worked quite well. Do you think this is something that could happen in France in the future? Well, if I tell you that, the French people will get entrenched. They will scream. That being said, France has also become, for a few decades now, a country of immigration. It should undoubtedly, but now I'm venturing outside my field of expertise, I believe that we become French gradually, and that we have to wait one or two generations before becoming fully integrated into the national community. But this is a very delicate subject. I know too well in my country.
Lors de sa dernière visite en France, Donald Trump
during his last visit to France, Donald Trump had controversial things to say.
Pas toujours d'un goût exquis, on peut s'autoriser à dire ça.
He talked about making France great again.
Make France great again?
What would you like to say to Donald Trump when he says things like that? You know, first of all, you have to understand that Trump's famous tweets are tweets addressed to the American people. It's American domestic politics. Therefore, his voters. His voters. Yes, he's right, since the mainstream press is completely hostile to him. I have great respect for the American press, but the New York Times and the Washington Post are almost running an election campaign against Trump. And so tweeting is a way for him to ignore the press and speak directly to tens of millions of Americans and to address them in their language, with their vocabulary. You mentioned the U.S. media. Do you have the impression that what explains this idea that Europe misunderstands Trump is the fact that the European press might feed off the U.S. media's hostile view of Donald Trump? Do you have the impression that the message becomes distorted when it crosses the Atlantic? I profoundly agree. That doesn't mean that I'm defending Donald Trump or attacking him. That's not the point. I would say that Washington voted 94% for Hillary Clinton, as did Manhattan. Here, Republicans and Democrats of all types are outraged by Donald Trump's behavior. He's here in the U.S. Capitol. In the U.S. Capitol, in Washington, we live in an atmosphere that is very anti-Trump. And therefore, in the press, which is also a reflection of the establishment, the same is true. Is this something you stand against? My job as an ambassador was specifically to try to understand what was really happening. I have an advantage over the Americans. I'm a foreigner. Therefore, in a way, I'm not influenced by the emotions and passions that the election of Donald Trump brought up and that I myself would have felt in France if Marine Le Pen had been elected. But I'm not personally involved, and so I was able to stay more analytical. You are often seen as a diplomat out of the ordinary. Have you often been told that? Because of the things you say and the positions you take? You can't be the ambassador to the United States in 2019 the same way as in the 1930s or as the ambassador to Beijing in 2019. So I may have made mistakes, but I try to modernize this profession.
et de le moderniser pour être
by using social media in particular. By using social media, yes. By trying to reinvent this career in the United States of America in 2019. But if I had been ambassador to Beijing, I would not have behaved like that at all, and would have stayed quiet, of course.
Voilà, j'ai essayé,
I tried something different, and I think my successor will be different as well.
Alors justement, à propos de votre
precisely, talking about your successor, he will soon arrive here. What are the three main pieces of advice you will give him when he arrives?
D'abord, je vais dire, il faut sortir de Washington.
First, I'm going to say that it is necessary to get out of Washington. Washington is not the capital of this country. It's not the economic, cultural, or the financial capital. It is only the political capital. And it's a bubble. In other words, where everyone thinks, sleeps, and dreams politics, it gives you a rather distorted picture of what this great country is like. You must try to take a step back, and it is all the more interesting because this is the first time in my career, and in the last half century, that American and European politics are so comparable. And so it is fascinating to see in real life this experience of what happens when a populist leader takes power in a liberal democracy, which is the case in the United States, and I think it can teach us a lesson. Trump is redefining the American right wing, and it's interesting because in a way it's a bit like what happened in France with the Républicain Party. A new right wing is making its appearance, more identity-oriented, more nationalistic. It's a new conservatism, very different from what Reaganism was. And now the question that will arise is, what will happen to the left wing? And that's why the 2020 election will be fascinating. Mrs. Clinton's defeat is the end of an era. What will it mean to be left-wing in the United States, and therefore to be left-wing in all Western democracies?
Monsieur l'ambassadeur, merci
infiniment. Mr. Ambassador, thank you very much. We can still call you ambassador for a few more hours. You've been watching the interview on France 24.
Here at France 24, we're taking a broad outlook by talking about the women who are reshaping our world.
En France 24 en español no tenemos temas vedados. Y eso se puede ver en televisión y en todas las plataformas que tenemos en internet.
في فرنسا 24 لا ننساو نحجز لكم اسبوعيا تذكره عوده للمدن والمناطق التي كانت في قلب الاحداث قبل ان تدخل في طي النسيان.
France 24 c'est la recherche permanente des meilleurs spécialistes pour vous permettre de déchiffrer l'actualité.
Claro que tiene algo especial, somos todos de distintos países y trabajamos con todo el corazón para entregar información en el momento preciso.
أخبار سياسية واقتصادية وثقافية وأيضا رياضية بأعين خبراء رياضيين هذه هي قناة France 24.